21st century class struggles on current state of capital and the generalization of the proletariat around the planet. There are different degrees of people think of this in different ways, and there are differences maybe even amongst our panelists. We're getting off to a bit of a late start, so I'd like to get moving. I don't know if amongst yourselves you have decided.
We're going to go this way.
Which way?
Starting.
You're going to start. We're going to go this
way. I'm going to start? Okay.
We're going to start with
Lewis Gordon.
Okay. Then move right across with Jane, Sylvia, and Manny. Tomorrow morning, we begin at 10 a.m. Juliet Uccelli will be speaking on Capital, meaning Das Kapital, and Marx's Method, followed with a number of other panels. If you haven't got it, there is a program available where you check in that has a complete schedule for all 4 days. Thank you, everyone, and let's get it going, Liz.
Okay, well, good evening. Thank you all for being here. I had a wonderful time on the opening panel. We were discussing the question of improvisation, and we looked at a variety of themes that segue very well into what we're looking at now. Now, one of the things we should bear in mind if we're going to raise the question of the 21st century is there's a tendency, I find, when we look through political theoretical work, there's a tendency to deal with political subjects, and especially if we're going to bring up the question of the proletariat, which is a political subject, we have a tendency to look at political subjects and political theories as if they exist in isolation of other political subjects and other political theories. So quite often, for instance, when people would say in political economy, talk about socialism, there's a tendency to talk about socialism as if socialism is a project that's being left alone in the same geopolitical space as capitalism. So it's as if there's an effort to build socialism and capitalism would say, you do your thing, we'll do ours. Now that's never been the case. There's always been the case of a concerted effort on the part of capitalism to undermine the potential of socialism, and the very existence of socialism, very project of socialism, is a challenge to the idea of capitalism. So the idea of talking about them outside of their relationship with each other makes no sense. We have people, for instance, when I hear people talk about the failure, for instance, of socialist economies, they often remind me of when people talk about the failure of coalition politics with the civil rights struggle. There are some people who have argued, for instance, that the transition to black power undermined the question of coalitions. Of course, they don't mention the fact that there was COINTELPRO, that the FBI was trying to undermine any effort to deal with a coherent revolutionary politics. They don't deal with the question of infiltration. They don't deal with police brutality. In other words, they don't deal with the fact that there was a concerted, violent effort to undermine any success of such projects. Now, I bring that up because if we're talking about the 21st century, we need to ask what the 21st century is in terms of political theory and political subjects. And I mention this because you see, obviously, the 21st century is coming on the heels of the end of the 20th century. Now, one of the things about the 20th century is if you go and look at, before you get into political theory or political philosophy, you just look at the history of the 20th century, it's unmistakable that the 20th century was a century of at least revolutions and efforts at revolutions. And revolutions at many levels, not simply in terms of societies, political economies, but also technologically. The very fact that we come out of the 20th century and the 21st century with radically different conceptions of how we relate to the things we use that make us seem almost cybernetic. So already there are all of these things in the 20th century. Now here's one of the problems with the 20th century. If you go and look to the 19th century, the 19th century people thought in a way that's very different than how people think in the 21st century. The 19th century was a century in which the very question in the 19th century was what was the 20th century to be. Do you see the difference in that consciousness? 19th century people weren't obsessed with being 19th century. They wanted to figure out how to be 20th century. Now, this becomes very crucial because if you look in the 18th century, it was a similar phenomenon. Something happened to make a lot of 21st century political discourse not actually about the 22nd century. Do you see what I'm getting at? This is a lot like the existential problem. If you try to think about where you are right now, it's the past. So in many ways, in order to understand where you are, you have to be thinking ahead of where you are. This becomes the crucial shift because you see the antagonisms at the end of the 20th century were antagonisms against the idea of futuricity. And without futuricity, you cannot have historicity because in a way to understand what you are historically, you're contextualizing it in terms of the projects of what you're trying to become. Now, if you look at the debates that closed off the 20th century, they became nostalgic debates. They became debates about which century prior to the 20th century we should inhabit as the end of history. So if you look on the one hand, if you think about what neoconservatism is, if you look at the thinkers, the logic, all of that, neoconservatism wants the end of history to be the 18th century. You see what I'm getting at? So it wants to be late 17th into 18th century. And that's one of the reasons why you go from the 17th, from people such as Hobbes and so forth, into the what's called the American Revolution in terms of the kind of thinking you had with Jefferson and those. Now, if you look at neoliberalism, again, wants the 19th century. The 19th century was the period in which you had the British Empire, global empire, and it's where within the British Empire the theoretical framework of the political subject was, if you look in John Stuart Mill, the individual and the doxological category of opinion. And so you now have, if you look at that, that maps onto neoliberalism very well, because neoliberalism says you're an individual, your rights are as individual. You're going to question at the level of opinion a world around you, and it's without question the theology of the system will be the free market. Okay? If you look at neoconservatism basically says it's about order and the free market. Now, of course, that becomes a very weird thing because you want a free market, which by definition means you can't order it, but they want to have order on it, so it deals with these contradictions. It becomes for whom? And the political subject, for whom, becomes then those who were able to be hegemonic or in power in the 18th century, you see? Now, you notice the peculiar absence in those narratives of the 20th century. And if you think about something like Marxism was trying to figure out, in the 19th century, the question of the 20th century, but not as a closed subject, because of the presupposition that the 20th century should be thinking about the 21st. And here's where we have the problem. What intervened is this concept called postmodernism. And what postmodernism begins to do is to attack the very notion of a political subject. It begins to attack the very notion that if you are trying to organize ideas, even the question of bringing things together is treated as imperial. This creates a big problem because, you see, if neoconservatism is pushing world order, globalism, neoliberalism is pushing market fundamentalism as the world order, and so you have the 19th and 18th century being the models. If you abrogate addressing the question of a globalism, then in effect what you have is leaving us at the 21st century stuck in the 19th and the 18th, and being afraid of the 20th. However, what's being offered in a lot of contemporary political theory has been these radical localisms that abrogate, that don't take responsibility for the kind of subjects that will face a 22nd century. And here is where it becomes very tricky. Because you see, if you now look, if you go back into the 19th and the 20th century, there's always been an intellectual tradition connected through to the kind of debate you had in trying to understand the 20th century that raised the question of what it is to be a human being, the very political subject at stake. And the political subject, in political terms, was understood historically as having been derailed. Now, what do I mean by this? If you take seriously colonialism, that the phenomenon of colonialism, in effect, says that the colonization, global capital, is a just order. Do you see what I'm getting at? And that means if it's a just order, to overturn it would be an unjust act. And this is what creates the problem. Because if it is a just order, it means all those populations that have been alienated and pushed outside of the realm of political subjects, whether they are indigenous Americans, indigenous South Americans, indigenous Australians, whether it be the question of the transformation of the peoples of Africa into the category of property and the category of black as being outside of the human terrain, whether it's a conception of women not as as human beings with agency, but as part of a propertied order. And you could go down the list of each of those. There are anthropologies through which, as you begin to bring them together, the question is, if there is a fundamental dissatisfaction with that order, which is exactly what revolutionary politics is, it means then that the order is at war in its identity against those subjects. And it's against them by arguing that they are intrinsically not subjects that properly belong in the integrity of the system. Now you have a very unusual situation. Because in effect, if you look at all the discourses around neoliberalism and neoconservatism, they argue, in effect, that the assertion of those communities would be an unjust act against the system, which would make them patently unethical. And now you have a problem. Because it means if you're going to justify revolutionary change in terms of ethics, the only conditions that will actually satisfy the order as ethical is not to change it. Do you see the problem? So in effect, because you cannot set justification in those terms, one now sets up a relationship of politics to ethics. And here's the problem that happens. If you look carefully at the discussions on the neoliberalism and neoconservatism, what is always under attack is the category of politics itself. Because precisely, since it has undermined the conditions through which to deal with ethical justifications, for those groups to be able to emerge as political agents, they can only do so politically, which means the political supervenes over the category of ethics. But this is a paradox, because nobody who is going to assert the rights and dignity of indigenous peoples, of people who are placed outside of the ordinary orders of employment, for instance, the not only the underemployed or the non-employed, but even the categories of people who are considered unemployable, which is what's coming from the incarcerating state. All those people, the only way they can actually become political agents and then be within the framework of ethical agents would be to do the political work as well. And so it's no accident that we're in a period in which the political activist is increasingly looked at as an unethical agent. Do you see what I'm getting at? Now, this leads to something very crucial then. And this is something that you see in Fanon, you see it in Szilard James, you see it in many others. You see it in writings that you could find, for instance, even debates that you see among the Zapatistas. And that is that if one is going to deal with the question of political subjects, you cannot deal with them reductively, you have to deal with them relationally. It means then that the conception of a proletariat cannot work within the old model of narrowly linked to certain sites of production. One has to now deal with the question of the human being, the philosophical anthropology of a human being, as the meeting of multi-subjects, all in a way in which one does not have a reductive singular subject moving. This means then that if we're dealing properly with a political anthropology, we're going to have to deal with a conception of how to do theory, how to do revolutionary theory that deals with the complexity and the set of relationships of the kind of human being that is emerging for the 22nd century. And a human being that's emerging for the 22nd century is a human being that's actually proliferating and creating more identities that are creating new sets of conditions under which we'll understand who we are in a new global order. And this global order is not an order in the neoconservative sense. What it is this, and this is where I'm going to end and move to Jane. It's a world in which the conditions are so radically different that we have to take seriously as a 22nd century problem. How does a population at this early stage of the 21st century deal with being 8 billion in a technological framework in which time and space themselves are collapsing into rapid interaction? It means, in effect, that we've already begun to become different kinds of human beings. And these different kinds of human beings are generating new political problems, which means then 22nd century ideas must address the question of global revolutionary thought. Okay, I'm done.
So first, thanks, Michael, for the invitation to participate in three really interesting days of sessions. What I want to do is to speak very briefly about the relationship of forced labor and slavery to the question of the generalizing of the proletariat. But I want to do that by saying a few things to frame what I mean by slavery and why I think we should be talking about it. And so if you look typically in political theory and in political economy, slavery is treated as a radical exception and is largely marginal. Horrific, terrible, lamentable, but largely marginal to the history of capitalism, to the history of the modern world. And in many ways, it's seen in a very particular sense. Typically, slavery is explained as responding to a very peculiar and rare circumstance of there being a radical need for labor at the same time as a radical labor shortage. And so you import people, typically across oceans, and then you make them an immobile workforce. So a group of people who cannot choose what they do by way of work, and precisely because they are immobile, they can't leverage their labor power. Right? This is how slavery is typically talked about by Marxist theorists. And in many ways, that way of thinking about slavery as radically distinctive and therefore curtailed in a very specific moment is often affirmed by historians of slavery. Right? Because many historians of slavery have argued that there are all of these instances that we can look at and translate into English as moments where people are enslaved. But in fact, they're so different that to even call them all slavery is to do an injustice to the uniqueness of what's actually going on in these cases. Right? And so many historians of slavery really argue that we can't talk about slavery in transhistorical, in a transhistorical sense or across time and place. And some of them are motivated to that commitment by another very important one, which is about insisting on the radical specificity of the transatlantic slave trade and the racialization of slavery that went on within it, which was connected to what Lewis was just talking about, right? That there are centuries of centuries where you actually have slavery and where you have, as enslaved people, multiracial populations, and where there is not colorblindness, right? Where particular nations of people are associated with particular kinds of work. And yet it didn't amount to a system like what we have in the Americas, where there are whole races of people who cannot be conceived of as free human beings, right? I mean, one of the peculiarities of the US South is that we couldn't conceive of free blacks as a coherent category, even though there were, in fact, free blacks. And it had everything to do with the fact that blacks are treated as an inhuman, subhuman, et cetera, category, right? And yet, what I think it's a disservice not to think about slavery in transhistorical terms. And the reason I say this is that I think in spite of the differences across circumstances, there are always very unique things that you see with people who are called slave or are called any other category of thing, but who are faced in this situation or are in this situation or are in this predicament. And there are a few things, right? The first is that a slave, regardless of the slave society, has no political standing, right? If there is a civil community, if there's a polis, that person does not belong in it. The relationship to the society in which the person's enslaved is always mediated by that person's owner or master, right? The second thing is that because there are instances in some slave societies where the slave is given something, right? Some kind of minor rights, some kind of property, it was typically called a peculium, some kind of standing. But the whole point with it is that it can always be radically taken away. That it doesn't actually belong to the slave, it belongs to the master of the slave. The third point is that a slave's labor is never recognized as the slave's contribution to the place where the slave is laboring. It always, again, is a contribution on the part of the master to the society where that slave is working. And the last is that the slave's consent is always irrelevant, right? And so if you think about slavery in those kinds of terms, it suddenly becomes very clear that this is not a very rare event, right? That there are instances where you can look at people who are laboring, and those four things that I just described are perfectly evident. And so one of the things that I've been thinking through, and I would encourage us to think through, is that it does seem kind of odd if we stop and think about it, to expect that slavery would always look the same way. So for instance, when the Americas were production societies, of course we saw slaves laboring, right? Of course there were, you saw slave and slave products all around you. But in an economy that's no longer a production society, one would fully expect that slaves would be doing different kinds of work. Work that would be largely invisible, like most of the other productive labor that actually does still go on in places like the United States. And so one of the things that I would suggest or urge us to bring to this conversation is to think about, when we're talking about the generalizing of the proletariat, the generalizing also of forced labor. And the typical sort of counterargument that's made when one says that is that many of the instances that people look at and call slavery begin in indenture, right? And so many people would say, this isn't slavery, this is indenture, this is slave-like. But then the immediate sort of answer to that is to say, well, why is it that there was a period where indenture actually was a temporary condition, where one was in something like a slave-like condition, but there was a point at which that relationship ended?
James, could you use the mic?
Sure.
They're having a hard time.
Sorry. Is that better? Yeah. And so the question then becomes, why is it that there was a period where indenture could really be meaningfully distinguished from slavery? This country is a very good example. And what is it that's eroded so that now indenture doesn't ever seem to end? It doesn't seem to be a temporary condition. It instead very easily collapses into something that is perpetual, which is because typically the way that indenture and slavery are distinguished from one another is that one is temporary and the other is not. And so some of the questions I think we need to think through are about things like that. Why is it that so many people are entering into indentured relations that make them so incredibly precarious in their laboring relations? The other is that with an economy that's changed as radically as ours has, the place where you see forced labor has also changed. You see it in instances and in domains where we don't know how to protect laborers very well. And there are all kinds of creative efforts coming to the fore, but they often aren't talked about in circles like this one, or circles where people are thinking about contemporary Marxism. So whether it's guest workers groups, or whether it's domestic service groups, or whether it's people who are caring for children, all of the kinds of work that hasn't been, house slaves, all of the work that hasn't been, and was deliberately left out of the union movement in this country because it was historically black work. The last thing that I would say is that I know many of the people in this room are very familiar with the work of Thomas Piketty, right? And some of the arguments are not at all new, right? The idea that wealth generates wealth faster than labor does is not a new insight. But the one that I think is really important is the way that he recharacterizes the political economic moment between the two world wars in this country and in Western Europe. Because a lot of Marxist theorizing treats that moment as a new period in the development of capitalism, right? It gets called advanced capitalism, et cetera. What he points out is that it was not. It was an episode where, because there were a lot of financial losses linked to the wars, there was actually some political leveraging that created policies that were redistributive so that people actually could engage in the political process who historically hadn't. And so what that, I think, implies is that we need to rethink that moment and say, what went right? and what is it that we can replicate, rather than thinking as it is sort of a moment that we are still in? Because in many ways, it was an episode that's over, but an episode from which I think we have important things to learn. Because if you look at the history of slavery, people like to think of it as ending in the 1800s, but you only really see a dip in it around the world wars. And so even thinking about this in terms of the history of slavery, which you have whenever there's radical economic inequalities, it was an episode and a blip, and one that we want to replicate. And I'll stop there.
Well, my presentation follows well on the question of forced labor. When I was asked to participate in this intensive, you know, I happened to be in Argentina and speaking with a various women's group. And one of the issues that was always raised was the question of violence against women. So when I was asked about what I would contribute to this intensive, that's what I decided to choose. Because if we are thinking about how proletarian consciousness, revolutionary consciousness is generalized, and in particular, what kind of strategies we can think towards a unification of the working class, then certainly the question of violence, violence in general, violence against proletarian people, but also against women, it's a central issue. Because it shows, among other things, it shows that, in fact, the process towards the unification of the working class and the class struggle is not what Marx has taught us. It's somewhat different from what Marx expected. When he claimed that the world expansion of capitalism would by itself, in a sense, produce a process of unification and a process of generalization. In fact, Marx envisaged, at least in the German ideology, you know, the creation of a universal proletariat, of a proletariat as a universal human being, because through the extension of industry, through the extension of capitalist relation, what would occur would be a homogenization of labor, would be the spreading of capacities among working class people that would increasingly make available to them, you know, all the skills and all the instruments of labor and productive capacities of the earth, of the world. Well, we know now that this has not happened, that actually the world spread of capitalist relation has produced more likely deeper division within the world proletariat. Certainly has produced not a process of unification, but an accumulation of hierarchies, an accumulation of differences. I would say that this has been a continuum through the history of capitalism, that capitalism has developed not only the productive forces, but has developed as well, you know, a whole hierarchy of labor that so far has been quite effective, you know, in keeping people divided. You know, it's been one of the ways in which a revolutionary process has been blocked. So I'm going to look at tonight, you know, as briefly as I can, at the ways in which the globalization of capitalist relation has affected women, and in particular why, you know, hand in hand with this process, you know, we have seen such a surge of violence against women that many have spoken of a low-intensity warfare. I decided also to talk about violence against women, and particularly, let me make clear, proletarian women, and particularly women of color, so not women in general. There is obviously a minor group of women who has, to some extent, benefited from the globalization process. So what I'm speaking is specifically proletarian women. I want to concentrate on the issue of violence because this has been an issue that has been so depoliticized, you know, has been so appropriated institutionally appropriated, you know, by the United Nations, by NGOs, that we have begun to, in a way, dismiss it as an important political issue. And it has been appropriated in a way that it has made it appear as a private domestic problem alone, and has hidden its structural roots, its structural characteristics, the fact that even though that violence is carried over by individual persons, that in reality the roots of it, the motivational causes, are very much in the organization of production, in the organization of work. And this is what I want briefly to speak about. First of all, I want to stress that violence against women has been built into the structure of gender relations, and in particular into the structure of women's work, what has been called women's work, reproductive work, and family relation, all through the history of capitalism. So the violence is not something new. When we speak of violence, we are not speaking of something new. That's obvious. But I want to say that the whole organization of family work and reproductive work has traditionally been permeated by violence, by the very fact that you have a situation in the classic family where the husband, through the wage, has the power to command and use the labor of women, right? So that situation is a situation that is potentially full of violence. You know, the husband has the power not only to supervise the work of women, of the wife, use it, appropriate it, but also to castigate her in case she does not comply. And this is why this is not a matter of good nature or bad nature, but it's something that is institutionally constructed within the fabric of the family, of the nuclear family originally. And this is why, for example, violence against women in the home has traditionally not been treated as real violence. Is actually been treated almost as a condition of work. And the state traditionally has not really punished it, has not seen it as a crime. In the same ways, for example, as violence against children in the home is not seen as a crime, but it's supposed to be part of the formation of beings, right, that are not yet considered as full human beings. You know, they are in training to become good workers, right? In any case, clearly with the globalization process, there's been a major change, right? There's been a major change because one of the two elements relevant to this discussion of the globalization process has been the crisis of the male wage, you know, the precarization of particularly of male labor, the end of the security of work, and the massive entrance of women into wage work. That, however, and I think is very important, has not changed, has not diminished the hierarchy between women and men, and certainly has not diminished the violence against women. In fact, hand in hand with that process, we have seen an escalation. Why that escalation? I think that there are many factors involved, and briefly I've mentioned those that seem to me more important, particularly if we think of organizing against it. First of all, you know, the appropriation by men of women's labor has not ceased, but it has changed form. Instead of the appropriation of domestic labor, of labor in the home through the wage, right, the classical exchange, the wage through domestic labor, what you have in many parts of the world is the appropriation of men of women's body and women's labor, which is in a way is then sold off through on the labor market, on the world market, through prostitution. In other words, that many men have used women's labor and women's body as the vehicle to connect to the world commodity market, as a vehicle to acquire the means of reproduction and the means of consumption that would enable them to, again, connect, reproduce themselves, and connect with the world commodity market. And for example, there was a whole discussion that we could have about the question, the role of microcredit here. You know, the fact that in many cases, women have take microcredit, but it's actually the husband who uses it, although it's women who must put up with the violence that is unleashed against them once they default, right? The whole relationship to, you know, trafficking, a lot has been already written about it. So these dowry murders have been another example, and this is one of... also, violence has replaced the wage. What you cannot acquire through the wage, you acquire now, you know. So the escalation of violence has been very much part of the crisis of the male wage. But there are also other factors that I think are extremely important. One, it's the kind of places and work, you know, in the women now, in which women find themselves now in the search for an income. And it's very important to look at that, because there's been so much emphasis on the emancipatory character of women's entrance into wage labor. And we lose sight of the fact that for the majority of women, actually entrance into wage labor has signified not only a double or triple shift, because many women actually have to have two jobs in order to survive, but also that access to an income, access to some form of wage, has come accompanied with a very high level of risk. Just think about migration, what women have to face through migration. We now know the immense amount of violence they have to suffer because of the need to resort to mafias, various forms of illegal organization in order to procure the documents to migrate. The encounter with the authorities, the encounters with the different polices of the world. Also, form of work that women have resorted to, given the difficulty of accessing a wage, has been working in the street vending, including vending their own body, you know, prostitution. Vending in the streets, which continuously puts you in a confrontation with the police, etc. And that this can also be expanded. Third is the attack that is now being taking place against subsistence farming and the massive land grabbing that is taking place across the world, which is impacting particularly women, because in many rural areas, women are those who are remaining. And what is most important in the process of privatization, land expropriation that is taking place, is that in response, one very common response is that in many communities, men have begun to draw again the definition of what is the common, who belongs to the common. So that, for example, in some parts of the world, many women have been pushed out of the land, you know, access to the land has been curtailed. And in some parts of the world, in many countries of Africa, India, Nepal, we have also seen a return of witch hunting, which has been directly connected, there's a whole literature that is now growing, to the question of land privatization. To the question of land privatization, where again, you find that you have corporations and local chiefs who are in complicity also with many times local youth who see no promise for the future, who see no hope of having any access to school or access to income, and are easily used against their own community, and particularly women, particularly older women, who seem to be, particularly when they still have hold on some piece of land or access to communal land. So this is a very important thought, and it's something that should be really discussed much more in depth, because already in Africa alone, it's calculated that more than 30,000 women have been killed. Some of the latest statistics, for example, in Tanzania, just in 2013, 700 women have been killed. These are statistics that are very approximative, because many of these murders are not recorded. But it gives an idea of the magnitude of the problem. And to add that most of these crimes remain unpunished. last in my presentation, is the growing militarization of life. And the fact that one of the fastest growing jobs for men, or type of job for men, is the type of job that requires violence. You know, over the last three decades, and for very obvious reason, right? Neoliberalism in all its forms, since neoliberalism is a massive attack on people's means of reproduction, an attack on lands, an attack on wages, an attack on services, it requires an enormous display of violence in order to impose itself. And because of that, what we have seen has been a state of permanent warfare with incredible increase of armies and the number of armies, armies not only by the states, but also private armies. You now have the corporation have their own private armies. We have seen an increase in the number of polices, prison guards, gangs, etc., narco-traffickers. So we have seen actually a process of what counterinsurgency and low-intensity warfare, very generalized, very, very generalized. And this means now that you have a proliferation of men in arms, and of men whose daily survival depend on the use of violence. And this has a direct impact, obviously, in the relationship with women. Not to mention the fact that this army generates their own economy, generates their own economy made of women who have to be prostitutes, etc. So I think this is very important to keep. This is an example. It's a very, what I've tried to give so schematically is an example of how, when we speak of violence against women, we have to look at it from a class viewpoint. We have to take it away from the kind of moralistic and men are bad perspective that has been promoted, for example, by the UN or certain types of liberal women's organization, and see instead that it's really very much a question of class, and that the transformation that have taken place with the neoliberal phase, with this new phase of capitalism, as such, that they demand, this massive attack on women, because after all, the foundation of this new drive, capitalist drive, is an attack on reproduction, is an attack on people's means of survival. It's a way of making more people propertyless, and therefore more easily exploited. And the control of women's body, the control of women's life, it's fundamental to that. It's a lot more to say. So I'll close here to just saying that it's very important, because what we are learning, and I think that Greece is one of the latest examples, but what we are learning is that impoverishment, the confrontation with immiseration and so forth are not enough to create a transformation, a unification of the proletariat, In fact, it can actually result in the opposite. You know, I think that what we are seeing today in Europe, and at this time, for example, there is a war against immigrants that is taking place now in different parts of Europe, and that really would need, I hope maybe we can talk about it in the discussion. So that this is not enough, and also that unless transformation takes place in people's everyday life, unless the division, the way in which we have been divided, are very seriously confronted, we are not going to be able to have any form of unification, neither this century nor the next, and no matter how much suffering there is in the planet, and no matter how much, you know, our condition appears to move toward some form of homogenization, you know, some form of homogenization of the type that we see, for example, today when we look at Greece and we say, Greece is going through now what Eastern Europe has gone through in the 90s and what Africa has went through in the 80s. And so there seems to be like a structural adjustment process that is now sweeping through the world and in a way would seem to promise, you know, the possibility of a unification. But that is not enough. We see that this is not happening. And in fact, within, in the midst of that seeming unification, we actually see incredible divisions. And this is where, and this is my last words, this is where the question of the transformation of the so-called everyday life, the transformation of reproduction, the transformation of gender relation, the transformation of the struggle against all forms of racism is crucial. And I have to say that it's important that the struggle against violence against women is growing across the world. In many, many parts of the world, this today is like almost the number one, you know, and in a very positive way. What is not happening is that men are organizing against it. What is happening is that we are having, this is still a women's issue. We don't see any serious male organization. There is small attempts here and there. There are groups of men forming, they call themselves anti-patriarchal men. And there's been a very interesting experiment here in New York, the male supremacy group that has begun to organize among men against violence against women. But by and large, this is still a women's issue, and it shouldn't be. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for inviting me and this panel. I'd especially like to say that I'm very happy that there is a Marxist education project here this year. Last year, it was teetering, and now it seems like it's on its way to a much more better footing and a much secure footing, and that this reflects the kinds of discussions that are going on around the world. And I think it's crucial here in New York City to have a school where Marxism and socialism and other kinds of projects of revolutionary change, of liberation, are discussed and examined, and where we come to different positions, that's fine, but perhaps we share in the idea that we can discuss crucial questions from a perspective of an environment where it's taken seriously. And on that note, I'd like to start by quoting a phrase that I just learned. Actually, I think I heard it before, but I thought it was so important. And it's, some of you may think of it as quite conservative. And it's by a friend of mine who I just met in Delhi, Achin Vanayak, a leading political scientist. And it goes something like this. It's very quick. Reject the probably impossible. Pursue the probably possible. I think that's a very easy thing to accept. And by that, I'm really revealing something about myself, and that is that I don't favor a utopian vision of socialism. I don't think that socialism is something that we have to strive for, that we're going to create in some kind of nirvana that, in my view, will never take place in my lifetime or anyone's lifetime, for that matter. That we are real people. We engage in various types of activities. Most of those have to do with reproduction and production. And we also are sometimes very giving, and we're also very violent at times. And that we have to accept that this is the human condition, and that many of our leaders and many of our colleagues will engage in the same kinds of activities. In that sense, I would say that I believe that we are actually in a very good place. If we look at the 20th century that I thought Lewis put forward in an analysis quite well, we have a history of the 20th century that I think many of us could be very proud of. If we reject our past, we reject a lot of what happened that was good. And that whenever we talk about what is taking place in the future and various trends that are coming up today with respect to social change and progressive radical change, a lot of them have their origins in the same kinds of struggles that were discussed by each of the speakers. And we look at the issue of slavery, that continues to this day in a different context. But the whole idea of unfree labor is something that's universalized in the world. People use unfree labor as a means to extract higher levels of profits within capitalism. Mm-hmm. And companies like Nike and major auto companies and so forth use unfree labor. We don't see it. In fact, maybe Nike doesn't see it, or Apple, but it's there. Mm-hmm. And with respect also to the struggle for women, that's something that's ongoing and something that will unfortunately never end. But it's something that we have to fight for on a regular basis. But it might become to a new level of understanding, and I think that's something, and I'm a total optimist, gives me some sense of hope. Otherwise, I don't think I can have hope in an ethereal world. It has to be real. It has to be concrete, something I know about. And of course, when we look at culture, culture is very important in advancing struggles, struggles of the Zapatistas, the struggles of indigenous people, the struggles of women's group and so forth are embedded in various cultures, but there is a material basis to these struggles of oppression, of exploitation and so forth. And through that, I do take a Marxist approach to understanding of the kind of world that we live in. But my charge today is to talk about labor and the working class, particularly in what most of you may know as the Third World, with a focus on South Africa, with something that is not so abstract, but actually concrete. I guess I'll start by saying that this is not a new phenomenon, this question about postmodernism. I think we've revisited this, or maybe we started thinking about this about in the 1980s, obviously, and it really became oppressive to me. I remember being a graduate student and thinking to myself, well, you know, how does this fit in with class struggle? Well, actually, class didn't have much to do with discussions about subalternism and about feminism and post-colonialism and so forth. Yet we have incredible forms of exploitation against indigenous people, struggles against against the exploitation of women, exploitation of every single group. And they are real, and they're rooted in various types of class locations, the kinds of work that we're engaged in. And I think we need to dissect, as some of the speakers, Jane in particular, pointed out with respect to unfree labor, and you did with respect to what some people call immaterial labor. I don't know if you do. I don't think you do. So, and that's why I don't believe it's immaterial. And I think we should have a discussion about that briefly, because I think it's real labor and that's exploited by capital. But there was an end of work phenomenon that many people, both on the right, conservatives like Daniel Bell, had advocated in the 1980s as being, you know, really, there's really no need to discuss labor in the working class because they're irrelevant. There isn't any labor in the United States. In fact, it's diminishing dramatically in Europe too. And pretty soon, with all these new technological developments, and we're going to have the panels on this in the days to come, there's not going to be a need for labor anymore. Not only here, but if you read the book by Daniel Goretz, who's a leftist, He argues that throughout, in the same way as Daniel Bell in some ways, that there's really labor is no longer a concrete category to understand. But in fact, even from here to throughout the world, we're still engaging in labor. Today, the major questions of inequality are related to the fact that people can't get jobs, people are unable to achieve their objectives, that the generation, the current generation is millennials, is unable to achieve the same level of wealth as their preceding generation, and the preceding wasn't able to achieve the level of wealth as the one before that. And therefore, even in this country, it's become a crucial issue of discussion, labor or the lack thereof. And in some ways, Bell and Gortz may have had it right that labor became irrelevant in this country, and ergo, there's kind of no need to discuss it anymore, and that there won't be enough of it to go around for many people. I actually do think that it's extremely important to recognize the issue of labor markets, the issue of unemployment, the reserve army of labor, that's crucial to recognize with respect to the world economy. And when we look at the concept that was used previously, the idea of generalized labor seemed to me as an interesting point of departure, because I think there is and there isn't. In some ways there is, in some ways there isn't. And I'm going to talk about where there seems to be a growth of a working class. By that I mean people who are engaged directly in labor, men and women, women and men, in the third world. There, you know, for instance, in places, I know you have a guest here who's speaking tomorrow or Saturday on China, where a very large share, if not a majority of the working class in the urban areas are women, and they tend to be more skilled, working in electronics and other factories. But I'm going to just talk about labor in South Africa, because I think that's what it said on the program. And also I have a concrete proposal for everyone here. With respect to the question here is that, so we've seen a decline in labor unionization in this country, in Europe, and really, to be honest, throughout the world. I remember back in the, you know, 10, 20 years ago, people said the United States was the exception to the rule. And they used a different type of exceptionalism to explain it, not the way that we hear it in the media today. And that United States was the exception because it was poor, that social benefits were not distributed on the same level as its counterparts in Europe, and so forth and so on. And I remember people would say, well, and I would agree that we have to look at Europe, Australia, Canada perhaps, and other developed countries to compare with the United States, that we can't compare the United States with Brazil or Mexico or Nigeria or Burma, because they have different levels of development. I think that is true, but at the same time, I think that we do have a growing level of equality in terms of industrial production that is focused. Let me just start again. We have a greater amount of focus of industrial production, much greater in the former third world, or the third world, if you want to call it that, and the global south. In other words, based on latest statistics, 75% of all production workers are in the global south. 75%. And that is something to behold. That means out of the population of workers in the world, some 3 to 4 billion, 3 billion are in the south. And what is happening in the South, and what specifically is happening in South Africa? South Africa and the South, South Africa is a country that emerged from the apartheid regime, and I would call it a country of the global South because the level of poverty there is incredibly high. A level of unemployment exceeds 50% for everyone, not just youth or specific categories. There are not major roads or infrastructures. People don't have access to school in the same way. And this is something true of countries of Africa and throughout the global south, Asia and beyond, that while there has been a slight increase in uptick of education, by and large, people don't have access not only to school, healthcare, and housing, but other kinds of social services like water, electricity, transportation, inoculation, I can go on, sanitation. or even the very right to live. And in South Africa, I think we have an exception, and I'll tell you why, and I think it has to do with the idea of democracy in some ways, bourgeois democracy in this context, that what happened in 1994 with the end of the apartheid regime was a granting of the African majority population, black majority population of South Africa, the right to vote, legal rights in some ways, but absolutely no rights with respect to the economy. There were certain preferences that were given to certain specific groups who had higher levels of education or were connected to leadership roles in one way or another. Cyril Ramaphosa would be one example. I may need water. I may take Cyril Ramaphosa, the vice president of South Africa today, is one example, who was the leader of the National Union of Mine Workers. But having been granted the right to vote was almost like, I don't know, it's not the equivalent of slaves being granted freedom. Mm-hmm. I think there's something a little bit more to it. Is it something like, you see where maybe I'm going, where serfs are granted the freedom from their feudal lords? Well, maybe it's something like that. And we saw what happened over the years in terms of revolutionary or social change, where people get a measure of rights, where people think they have more rights than they actually have. And I think that's the case in South Africa, where people had from the very beginning thought that, hey, we have the right, we have democratic rights, we're just like white people. We're just like white South Africans. There's no difference between us. And since 1994, there has been an ongoing, it's never stopped, the end of apartheid did not stop the struggle for freedom in South Africa. It's continued to this very day, and it's reaching a new level, a new apogee. And this has taken place starting around 2009, continuing to 2013 with the, forgive me, 2013 with the tragedy that took place, the massacre at Marikana, where 34 mine workers were killed by the state police of South Africa, and has been an ongoing battle and has been violent at times. That's why I say I think, you know, we have to minimize violence as much as possible, but we're not going to eliminate it completely. I mean, people who are involved in struggles sometimes have to protect themselves. And we have other examples of it. I'm not saying it's, this is not violence against women. This is violence of the state against people. And we talked about this question earlier. I mean, it was discussed on this panel, the growing level of state violence against individuals, not just in South Africa, but throughout the world. In South Africa, there is a major level of violence in the municipalities, in the cities such as, municipalities in cities such as Soweto, outside of Johannesburg, and other areas where the majority of people do not have basic services. But in South Africa, in 2009, but really even before that, there was the beginning of a labor movement, primarily in the mining sector. Many of these people were migrant workers and remain so, from various regions of South Africa and Southern Africa. And many have suffered dramatically low wages. What happened is that workers said, you know, we want to get paid decent wages, just like since platinum is such an important and expensive commodity that costs something like $1,400, I think, an ounce. We want to get our share of it. And these are workers who are working underground, and there are women workers underground as well, as rock drillers and other kinds of, in other capacities. And in place after place in a region in the mining belt of South Africa, north of Pretoria and Johannesburg, called the Northwest, there has been the growth of a major labor movement. And what happened in this process is the primary union representing these workers no longer represents most of them, doesn't represent hardly any of them. What happened in 2009 to 2013 to create this, to the present, this dramatic transformation, is that the union did not serve the interests of the workers. The union said no to wage increases. The workers demanded something like three times the wages that they were getting. And by the way, they got a lot of it over the years. They were able to achieve these gains. without the primary union, the National Union of Mine Workers, engaged in the struggle. Just very briefly, because I think I'd like to be specific and concrete, the National Union of Mine Workers of South Africa is a union that comes out of the agreement, the tripartite the tripartite coalition that came out of the agreement between the South African Communist Party, COSATU, the major union federation, and the ANC. And they represent, unfortunately, the forces of capital, the forces of neoliberal capitalism. These are the same people who would exchange jobs as union presidents for being on the board of directors of the main mining multinationals in Switzerland or London or even Johannesburg and other places, and the Caribbean, some of these islands up there. And what's happened over the last, I'll just give you one example, last year, and it would have been happening right now in South Africa a year ago, there was a major strike that began in January of 2014. It continued till June, a 5 to 6 month strike of 70,000 workers. The workers paid hard because they weren't getting paid hard with not getting paid. They were oppressed. The workers were remembering a year and a half earlier, they were killed in a major state operation against them that was supported by the National Union of Mine Workers. They are now seeking a Marxist-Leninist form of political coalition. And I use that term because that's what they use. That's the terminology that workers in South Africa and the working class use. A wide coalition, actually, I could go beyond that. Marxist-Leninist, Fanonist, Sankarist perspective, which means African-centric perspective of understanding that they could make a difference in South Africa. And that difference will really contribute to gaining a new right, and that would be economic rights, which they have none of. So that strike was, many would say, was won by the mine workers. They were able to push the union, a new union that was formed, that didn't seem to have a political perspective, but was willing to take it on, union called the Association Mine Workers Construction Union. And they were able to push them under their leader, Joseph Muthunjwa, to stay in the strike. Because if Muthunjwa said, no, you know, I think we're going to probably concede here, the workers would, you know, dare I say, they would go after him. Not physically or anything like that. They'd reject his leadership and so forth and so on. What I'm saying is that the workers' movement in South Africa, I mean, some unions are quite good there, the NUMSA workers' movement and so forth, and many of the leadership and organizers in South Africa, are very good men and women leaders. However, they're being pushed in many cases by rank and file movements. And therefore, it does create the question of how do we understand autonomism and leadership, the degree of self-management, which I think is a crucial issue. How do we create workers' committees? And I think actually we don't create them, workers create them. They're done independently by workers. And I would say without question, this is perhaps the most dynamic workers' movement in the world, because they actually do challenge the economic system that exists of neoliberalism in South Africa. And many of the goals and objectives of yet to be formed parties, yet to be formed alliances and so forth, such as the United Front, which exists but could become strong in the years to come, represent the idea that the struggle against apartheid is not just a struggle against the white leadership, because today white people in South Africa control probably more wealth than they ever had, that no change has been made whatsoever. Poverty rates have grown dramatically, as well as access to essential services and so forth. And struggles are going on as we speak in the townships over electricity. People are hooking up electricity independently without sanction by the state corporations. And I close by saying that there is going to be a solidarity rally here in New York City on the 16th of August, which is a Sunday, at 3:30 at the South African Consulate in New York City, 3:30 to 5 p.m., which is in 3 weeks from Sunday. And it is noteworthy because this deals at this, it's 333 East 38th Street, right near the, not far from the UN. And I say this in very, if I can just have a few more minutes, or maybe three or four more minutes, I usually don't go long, that in April, I was asked by a number of comrades if we can get solidarity statements from African-American organizations, because these South African activists, many of them trade unionists, mine workers and their families, were protesting against the killing of Eric Garner, were protesting against the killing of Michael Brown and others, were in solidarity and chanting Black Lives Matter. These were the questions that they continue, because Black South Africans' lives matter as well as African American lives. And that was a crucial point. And I said in response, and many others, leaders here in this country said, we have to do the same. Because if Black Lives Matter here in this country, why can't they matter in South Africa? And therefore, the union that I'm a member of has endorsed is organizing this demonstration, a rally, a peaceful rally, on the 16th. This is actually a picture of the Marikana workers. I could send everybody a PDF of this if they'd like, but I'd like to pass it around if I can. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to be very concrete in this, because I think we here in New York can make a huge difference in their struggles. When we talk about class struggles for the 21st century, they're going on today. And these people are fighting for peace. They want to see an end to the violence by the police, not just the political, the violence through the barrel of the gun, but also the violence that's based on economic inequality and other kinds of oppression that goes beyond the mining industry into other forms of manufacturing throughout South Africa, as well as in the service sectors. Anyway, I think my time is up. I thank you for the opportunity for speaking, and congratulations on the Senate.
So, in our first panel, we took a bunch of questions, but I think tonight, because there's four of you, we'll take two or three at a time. So, any?
Thank you, everybody. And I loved those questions bebopped in that first session. If you weren't here, it was like we had music through the questions, because everybody kind of riffed off the next question. So feel free to riff off mine. So Professor Gordon, I think I'd like to ask you to talk about, yes, with the red hat. I'd like to ask you to talk about, how men in the capitalist, whether global south or global north, can actually talk and do what Sylvia was talking about. And for the brother who talked about the workers, what unions do you think, especially in this country, we could really put pressure on, since your union is already actively doing something? Because at the Left Forum, they really talked about this as, and then anybody who wants to answer in the audience or on the panel, shall we support the Cuban workers, and if so, how, as a model?
Thanks. Thank you very much to all of you. I'm a little bit surprised that there's been no mention, unless I missed it, of the transformation in consciousness coming about with the destruction of the planet and the earth and the ecology. And to leave that out, and it seems to me to be just repeating the errors of the past and so forth. And I think that's a big mistake. The privatization of the living cell and of the human and other genomes of living organisms as a new form of colonization that's opened up. And what would be then the role of the working class as it exists and as people are fighting around these issues in organizing, with that as a main component in what we're fighting for. And I'm sort of shocked that that was left out by everyone.
Any other questions, comments,
right
now?
I wonder if any or all of you could address what seems to be a kind of an anomaly, which is that you know, we do are thinking of the thinking that what Manny called the and others described the deindustrialization of the North, and the fact that there aren't jobs for all the people that want jobs. And at the same time, and you pointed out that 75% of production workers live in the global South. And at the same time, we have the phenomenon of these mass migrations from the South and the East and to the North, to people who desperately want to get out of where they are and go to places and actually work in horrible conditions for poverty wages in the North. So clearly I certainly think it's true that 75% of production workers are in the South, but there doesn't seem like there's work in the South either, even though obviously there is a great extension of industrialization in some countries, at least in the BRICS countries, and yet people are still anxious to do really bad work in other places. It's really this worldwide, it's not just to the United States, if people going to Europe, people are going from South Asia, trying to get into other parts of South Asia or to Australia.
So that's quite sure. A bit between the, should we go in the same order you began with?
Sure.
For the live stream.
The first thing is the point I was making about the question of thinking about the 22nd century is connected to the very point you made. There are a lot of people who think that all of our issues at hand have been laid out ahead of time, when in fact, if you're talking about 8 billion and growing and a compressed planet, the conditions that we have to deal with is, for instance, the question of the, it won't be the end of the planet, but it's talking about the end of us. Because even with ecological destabilization, there are different forms of things would be there. So the question that we're dealing with is, if we're going to deal with thinking about what's the relevant question at our time, and I could use a Gramscian phrase here, we have to deal with what issues are organically linked to us. And you've raised one of them. The second thing I'd like to bring up is connected to something a little more, just to get straight into it. If you look at what James talked about, if you look at the question of the history of enslavement, Euro-modern enslavement, one of the rules of Euro-modern enslavement was that it could not happen on European soil. And so all of the atrocities that were going on in terms of transatlantic slavery and also Indian Ocean slavery, because a lot of people don't realize it was global. There's a reason there's a New Zealand, for instance, is that it could happen as long as it's not seen. And this, you see what I'm getting at? So actually, in the history also of Europe, there was an effort to create a distance in terms of the visible sites of production. Now, this is crucial because, you see, if we understand the question of our production is linked to questions also of how we understand what human beings are, that means implicit in the model is those who are at the level of material, physical production are being pushed away from a connection to humanity. And this becomes very crucial because the less your humanity is actually pointed out, it at the structure of ethics, for instance, it means almost all can be done to you. In other words, all is permitted. Now, this becomes very crucial because I was having a conversation with Jane, for instance. Many Americans actually don't see production. Many Europeans don't see production anymore. And interestingly enough, many South Africans, what we see are services. And that's very different. Now, it's not to say service isn't labor, but the idea of labor that's linked to production, it creates the sense as if material things happen almost by magic. Now, the South African example is a rather interesting one. Because it was funny, I was giving a talk in South Africa a few years ago. People kept talking about the black middle class. And the thing that's really hilarious about this is at that time, the population has since grown in South Africa, but at that time it was 47 million people in South Africa, okay? And of the 47 million, as people kept talking about the black middle class, I asked, what do you mean by black middle class? How many people are you talking about? And you know, the number at that time, which was 3 years ago, 75,000. You see, one of the things people don't realize is when we're talking, since it's about proletariat, the category of working class in South Africa, working class, is very small. For blacks, we're talking about over 70% unemployment. And one of the things we miss about something like the case of South Africa, the best thing that could have happened for that kind of exploited capital was the transition to the current South Africa, precisely because it legitimized the settler state. What many black South Africans are arguing is that the settler state is premised on a way of maintaining the lock that whites have over capital, which, and I'm saying whites precisely because if we're talking about a philosophical anthropology of human beings, in a framework like South Africa, blacks are not human beings. And that means that fundamentally, if you look at groups, for instance, like Abulalia Bespanjolo and other groups that are very active in South Africa, those groups are being brutalized precisely because as non-human beings, they're outside of the framework of what would be appear as properly violent behavior. Now, in other words, if violence only can be done against you if your humanity is recognized. Now, here's where it gets very tricky. Whenever we're talking about, what we're talking about is the question of how these organizations of identities are linked to questions of power. You can't talk about politics and states without power. But the thing about politics and states when we're talking about power is that power makes sense the extent to which it can actually be spread or extended beyond the physicality of the body. And this is one of the reasons why people who are linked to the physical production tend to have power diminished in them, because actually their reach is with their bodies. A state is powerful in a legitimate sense, the extent to which it does not have to deal with the physicality, because one can understand its rules and regulations as legitimate. So where you see increased violence is actually when you see the eroding legitimacy of a state. And so we're seeing increased violence in the world today precisely because more and more people are not only being locked into their bodies, but the states themselves are losing their legitimacy. And as they begin to lose that legitimacy, it means in order to get things done, which is what power is about, to make things happen, it has to force it to be done, which increases now, precisely because we're talking about this being done to human beings, it creates the growth in violence. Now, this is connected to your question there. You see, one of the tricky things that's happening in the new kind of rhetoric around global violence, if you look at the actual language of how it manifests itself, it is actually, if you look at the South African example, by making, now solidifying the legitimacy in terms of whiteness, it has done something rather peculiar, and it does it even at the level of gender. If you look in South Africa, in a lot of particularly the academic discourses, the problem in South Africa that's being formulated is not just there, it's happening in South Asia, it's happening in Latin America, in many places. The fundamental problem that's being articulated by those intellectuals is not this erosion of the extent to which people can actually have an impact on their societies beyond their body. Increasingly, they're structured in such a way that only certain subjects can be recognized as capable of being violated. You see what I'm getting at? So for instance, violence exists if you harm whites. People who call the civil rights struggle nonviolent, why? Because a smaller number of whites were harmed than blacks. You can harm as many blacks as you can, it's not violence. If you're in a context in which women are not recognized as human beings, you can harm as many women as you'd like, it's not violence. However, what has happened in the neoliberal moment in the transition has been to invest more the category of humanity in opposition to categories that have become excess non-usable labor. And if you look at South Africa and you look at a lot of the global South, that actually has become men of color. And in fact, if you look at what's going on, if you look in South Africa, they would argue the fundamental problem with South African society is black men. And this has created a situation in which, if you look in the South African Academy, the discourse, what it does is to structure it that the protection of all women, women of color, white women, all women, becomes a function of the extent to which one can limit the activities of men of color. Now, of course, what's problematic here is that the more you put these men as trapped into their bodies, how do they exercise their agency? It's going to be through the very physicality, which comes to whom? The women who are closest to them. You see what I'm getting at?
So, I get the part about what we can do about it.
I know, but what I'm saying, but this is what I'm trying to get. That logic paradoxically presents as for the cause of women, you see what I'm saying? It locates the problem in a category of people who actually don't really have the agency. And so what happens is the conditions increase that's going to affect the women and the men of color, precisely because the state itself and loses legitimacy is going to increase the mechanisms of violence, which is the action of an illegitimate state. Now, in terms of the things that can be done about it, one error, I don't want to talk too long, but one error is that we have a tendency to forget, we're not looking at the models of treating empirically conditions that actually worked. And here's an example I give. If you look at blacks in South Africa, the discourse right now is that blacks are somehow failing at the production of wealth. And in fact, I was at a conference about South Africa recently where there were American economists who were saying what South Africans can do to make their conditions better, and by extension other Africans, is to take seriously that as China expands, it will need cheap labor. And it's in effect to make themselves the cheapest labor for the Asian economy. Do you see what I'm getting at? It doesn't ask the question of the production of the economies in Africa. It simply presupposes that they have to be the cheapest labor available for other economies. So one of the things that has to, and here's the part that's missed. If you're talking to black people, in the United States, or in South Africa, or in Kenya, or many other places, one of the things all over the world they don't even question is, why is there structurally white wealth? What produced white wealth? There's more than that. What produced white wealth was not simply chattel slavery, but the actual success of the social welfare state for whites. Remember, South Africa had a social welfare state for whites, and it created white wealth. It was part of the negotiation from the 80s going into the 90s for the transition from apartheid to get rid of the social welfare state to produce privatization for us when the larger population of people have never had the infrastructural conditions of that social welfare state for blacks. So blacks, same thing after the United States. White wealth in the United States was created by the period of social welfare state with laws preventing blacks from having access to that in this country. Black poverty was structurally produced in the United States. White wealth was structurally produced. And then after the civil rights movement, blacks are told to produce, when in fact, if you go to the 19th century, right after Reconstruction, there was black wealth being produced. And in fact, blacks as a group was actually doing better economically in that period of Reconstruction. But Jim Crow and others basically destroyed that wealth. So one of the things we have as an empirical fact is that the mechanisms of a social welfare state work. We know this because we have evidence for it, which is white wealth. The problem we have is that the experiment of destroying the social welfare state for the ideology of Friedman's type capitalism, that non-empirical example has been used in terms of structural adjustment policies and others. You're right to bring up Greece. In the global south, not to see whether it works in the sense of producing larger wealth for the population. The experiment is to see how much one can get away with in shifting the wealth even more into the few, and how much can be tolerated. So the empirical evidence, because if you think about it, structural adjustment has never worked anywhere. Why do we keep using it?
So you mean bring that up as a real clear point so that people can realize, the men especially, you're being duped into...
You're being duped, but also it means that we're being conditioned simply to abandon dealing with a more rigorous theory of how to create social welfare states or socialism, because it's being treated a priori as a failure.
Okay, so on a very practical level, because there's probably some people watching that won't have all this mental acumen with them. So, for example, in the Black Lives Matter movement, how do you translate what you just said to get men of color, especially women, white, to see?
I'm saying it's the wrong question.
Okay, so what would be
the reason?
It's a very practical
I know. The reason I say it's the wrong question is because no group of human beings can work isolatedly
in that way. Right, but there is a great division, and what I'm trying to get you to help me to go out and organize is, what is the question that you start posing so people can start thinking in that more profound way?
One of the things that people should be thinking about is similar to what we talked about earlier, which is that we have to understand that we are dealing with building the actual conditions we need, and to treat the past conditions as if they're etched in stone is the only way to go won't work. Second, we have to understand that the concept of men in isolation doesn't work, or women in isolation. It's just like talking about black in isolation or white in isolation. Human beings are actually relational beings, and so there's no way to do anything that affects one group that doesn't affect another. So we have to have a more rich system of action that actually has an impact that expands power rather than makes it hoarded in one particular group, or even worse, lock larger groups to be actually only in the reach of their bodies.
I got it. So you know what I challenge you later? Come up with a simple slogan for that. You know why?
I'm going to stop right here, but the short version is this. Our political action, we have to understand as human beings the distinction between a choice and an option, okay? Options are what are objectively available to you. If your options are expanded, you don't exhaust the choices you make. If your options are limited, then the only thing, your choices begin to be only about you. The language I use is you implode. Political action is about expanding the options available to people through which the choices they make in life can become meaningful. There are the options that are available for many people in the global south, the options that are available for many people around questions of gender and sexuality have become increasingly limited, which is why we're living in an age in which people are spending more time trying to fix themselves instead of the society that has limited the options available to them.
Because I realize time is short, I'm going to be really quick. There are three points I want to make. The second to address the question of the environment, the first picks up on something that Lewis was saying, and it was just something I'd wanted to mention earlier, because this is the beginning of a longer discussion. One of the things that may strike all of us, because all of us teach students in university settings, is that there's a growing anti-statism among many of our students. And by anti-statism, I don't mean challenging the state. I mean the complete erosion of the idea that the state can be a mechanism in creating the kinds of meaningful opportunities and wealth accumulation that Lewis was just referring to. And so I think one of the things that's useful to think through in terms of practical activism is distinguishing between challenging a corporate state and actually fighting for the kinds of states we deserve. And I think that needs to be more and more part of our discussion if we're not gonna lose the leaders that we need. In terms of the question of the environment, there were actually two points I'd wanted to make and I forgot to make, so I'm glad that you raised the question. The first is that whenever you see the growth of unfreedom and the growth of slavery, it's always tied to moments of primitive accumulation. And primitive accumulation in the way that people like Rosa Luxemburg and many others have subsequently talked about. Sylvia had mentioned the attack on sustainable agriculture, which is also tied to environmental questions. But also, there's this constant proliferation, right, of spaces that are seen as not valuable, that then become lucrative, that are then expropriated, then enclosed, and then the process that follows. And one of the things that's remarkable about the present is that it's not only going on in environmental spaces, but they're the creation of new kinds of spaces, right? So primitive accumulation is going on in the virtual and digital worlds as much as it's going on in Northern Colombia and in Detroit and, you know, et cetera. And so I think one of the things that we have to do is rethink what we mean by the environment to incorporate other forms and versions of primitive accumulation that are going on. But the last point is actually linked to something that Manny was saying, which is part of the shift of the sort of the center of industrial labor to the global south is that we're talking about a different kind of laborer, right? So there are industrial urban laborers in the global south, but there are also people who are laboring in much more rural environments or environments that have a different history of the territory and landscape. And so, for instance, one of the things that was really striking in the Marikana murders was that many of the people who were doing the shooting, Africans included and whites, before shooting the African laborers, called them kefirs, right? And the idea was these were Africans who were too African, who were too indigenous, who were too tied to ongoing living customary traditions, who were not Cape Townians or from Johannesburg. And so there was a sense that they were tied to indigenous movements that groups like the ANC are no longer at all listening to, right? And the other thing, I mean, it also links to the question of Latin America, right? Where, you know, struggles for economic rights have always also been tied to struggles for land and for nature. And so in many ways, the forefront of talk about, I mean, about environmental rights is going on in Latin America, right, where these rights are being constitutionalized and tied very directly to indigenous communities as the people who can actually interpret what it means for the environment to have rights at all. I mean, the question that I would pose regarding that is whether rights is really the language that we need for talking about these kinds of things. But I think the point is for us to think through, you know, that, you know, where these things are happening. And I think the last point I would just say is, while it's true that labor is obviously, you know, shifting to the global south, I think that language is also very limited, right? Because in the end, there's all kinds of labor that is going on in the global north, not only that people are migrating to do, but often that's linked to what Sylvia was saying. I mean, there's a whole professional class of bourgeois women who benefited from bourgeois feminism, who have women of color from the global south doing the domestic work they once did. And that's labor. And I think it's a real disservice to not talk about it as labor, because that's where a lot of labor activism has to go on the global north today.
Yeah, very good. I wanted to expand that, say that when we talk about production, what we're talking about, because we keep talking about production as if it was only industrial production, whereas the production of life is production. And so, you know, women's work is not only servicing people, but it's producing something. The question I just want briefly to say that today across the world, I think much of the violence, for example, against women is because women are in the forefront of struggling to the defense of the environment, the defense of the common, against the privatization of communal land, but also against the destruction of the environment. You can see that everywhere, you know, against rivers being polluted, chemical. In Japan, for example, women have been organizing, have been the first to organize against the government, forcing the government to release information about Fukushima, and then getting the Geiger counters to see the level of contamination. And this is really an international, because they are the first on the front line, having to take care of their family, having to decide whether they're feeding poison to their children, whether their children can play in the ground. So there is a continuity between the struggle over reproduction and, in fact, the struggle over the environment. And I think that that's where the most promising, you know, line of intervention today is in the world. And but definitely, you know, sometimes because of shortness of time, you cannot touch on all this, but it's a continuous.
Well, I think that we need to distinguish violence coming from capitalism, corporatism, the state against women and the environment struggle.
But
and then men and women together who are linked arms. So I think in the course of the struggle, that presents an opportunity to combat the violence that's coming out against women and against others. People work together to fight against it. So I think that's the distinction.
Yeah. But I think I was trying to make it before, perhaps, you know, too quickly, but I was trying to make it before that, in fact, the violence against women is never a private matter because it has structural roots. And even though it has structural roots and many times it's corporate. It has a very corporate origin. Nevertheless, it still uses, for example, it still uses the division between women and men in the community, or creates those divisions. For example, in the case of the witch hunts that are taking place in Africa, it's very clear that the commandos, the people who are actually carrying on the execution, in many times are very young men, unemployed, and young men who see who are part of community that have completely been disintegrated, who have no hope for their future, and they can become, they are very vulnerable to being recruited as mercenaries in all kinds of war against their own communities. And you know, women are some of the most first targets, particularly older women, and women who have access to some land, whom may be seen as not producing anything any longer for the community. Obviously, there is a continuity. For example, there is a continuity, in my view, between all the propaganda and the campaigning that the World Bank has made against subsistence farming, you know, saying that this is the cause of poverty in the world, saying that, you know, there's poverty in the world because people are using the land to support themselves, whereas the land is not productive. Money is productive, not the land. And the land is only productive if you use it as a collateral, you know, to get a loan in a bank. That's, imagine, you know, it's a total inversion of values. And yeah, and so that the woman who works, you know, in a patch of land to bring some food to, for her family or her community, that woman is seen as a cause of poverty, right? In the same ways as she's accused of producing too many children, etc. It's an ongoing campaign, right? But then, of course, what happens, it's again, that those policies have to be implemented by means of people, are being implemented by people in the community. It's like, who is in the armies, of many of the armies, which today, you know, are destroying the planet. So this is the kind of, and they, I think there is a continuity between the micro of everyday life, the micro of reproduction, of the divisions that are implanted at the level of everyday reproduction, and then the macro of the wars, of the expropriation, etc. And I think it's extremely important. I think that has been one of the lessons, the most positive lesson of the feminist movement. And I think that that's something that has to be also translated into organizational practice. I think that this is something that is already happening in terms of women's organizing. I think that that level of organizing has also had to be done by men. I think that men have also have to educate other men. They have to organize, not only educate, but organize in terms of preventing and fighting against that kind of violence.
Just a couple of points. Yes, there are other unions involved in this event, including SEIU 1199 and a number of others. About the question of ecology, I remember at the time, I guess it was September last year, late September, of the Global Climate Change March, I met with some Indian trade unionists, and there are some of the few people who actually came to New York City. And by the way, I think Sean Sweeney is speaking about the subject as well. Sunday evening session. But they were, I mean, I don't want to just mention them by name, and there are other trade unionists in the Global South who were very disappointed because they seemed to be, they felt like they were ignored completely. Their issues were not the same. But when you think about every car, I was just thinking about the, again, it goes back to Marikana. What do they produce? They produce platinum. What is platinum used for? Catalytic converters. What are catalytic converters for? It takes the pollution out of the automobile. These workers are being killed, and they're exploited at a high level, and they're organizing. But these are workers who are, some might argue, green workers. They're fighting for a better life for themselves, but they're also creating cars that are more efficient. On the other hand, those same cars also pollute. And if we take a look at the number of cars yes, there's a lot in poor countries, but it comes, there's no comparison in terms of the level of pollution. What is it? The United States produces 25% of all global pollution or something like that. Mm-hmm. And yeah, many of the questions, I think, I don't know if Lewis you're dealing with it, but I think you were, the question of imperialism. And then imperialism may have connotations that relate to ecology. That many people who are activists, unfortunately, don't recognize that people are struggling for their lives. If you live in a place like Chennai in Tamil Nadu in India, you can't breathe the air. In many other places, you cannot breathe the air, period. And a lot of people in the United States remember cities where you couldn't breathe the air. I certainly do. And you get asthma, and you know, if you're a young child, you'll grow up in some way unwell. Or children who are stunted. I think 40% to 50% of the, and I'm not exaggerating, this is a World Health Organization statistics, 40 to 50% of children in Indonesia are stunted. It means that they won't grow very large, and they'll get sick and die at an earlier age. Their life expectancy is limited. And I think that when we look at ecology and so forth, and especially climate change, I think we're not as sensitive as we could be to questions of, well, where is the production being done? Who's being exploited? What is the air like to breathe in these places? Which I can get into great depth if you'd like on those questions. Also, occupational safety issues are unbelievably they're horrendous in some of these countries. And life expectancy is much lower for working class people, men and women. And one thing I definitely agree with the fact that, you know, was raised by Sylvia about women, it's a crucial question, not just a question, we need to organize around women's rights. But I'm seeing increasingly women as workers in production settings, in service settings, and doing work at home, obviously, or work, what Marx called reproductive work. So you have both these categories, and in many cases, I think even in Africa, there, you know, places like Kenya and Tanzania you're talking about. Right.
So very simply, why, if the world, if so much poverty is across the world, if so much pollution, everybody knows we are eating shit. Everybody knows they are poisonous. There's war everywhere. So why don't we have a revolution? Eh? That's a good question. Why don't we have a revolution? So maybe we have to go back and understanding some of the practices, some of the relations that are blocking that process. I only mention one. I mention one that I think is very important, but is not obviously the only one. But we have to understand what is that in our life, yeah, is blocking those processes of coming together, of really being a very strong mobilization capable to withstand the incredible force, the incredible power, which at times happens. Like the people, this man died few minutes after this picture was taken. He died, eh? But you know, he was killed. He was murdered. You know, he was, right? So that capacity to rise up is there, but it's not something that is generalized. That's what we are talking about. How it is generalized. And so I think what I'm suggesting is that we also need to look at what are the processes that are blocking. So for example, if it is the case, you know, that there is a very, very generalized male violence against women, including or starting male proletarian violence against women, that means that all those women that are being violated, sexually, non-sexually, psychologically, physically, will not be able to fight against capitalism. This is something, for example, the women's movement had discovered. That if we wanted to fight against capitalism, fight against the system, call it what you want, many times you have to fight with your husband. You have to fight with your brother, with your father, because they cannot let you go to a demonstration. Now, magnify that. Multiply that. Right? Multiply the fact of all the women have to stay home and work and children, taking care of the elderly, taking care of this or that, three jobs, dealing with all the amount of violence that has been surging across the world. You really see that the class struggle is being sabotaged. This is not the only way, right? But obviously, that kind of unity, of unification, of generalization that would be necessary, you know, to build a strong mobilization against capitalism, not just the mobilization, I don't mean, you know, showing up 50,000 in a city, in a square for one day, but something that is sustained, right? Obviously, something has to happen. Obviously, transformation has to happen in our lives. I think that the case of what has happened in Greece, which also leads very nicely to me, I too have something to distribute. Yes, but something that is happening in Greece, I think is very interesting. Because everybody has seen the injustice of it, the absolute injustice of what has taken place. Not that this was the first time or it was exceptional injustice, because actually Eastern Europe had been devastated all through the 90s, all through the 90s, Africa even before and even more. Latin America, remember, 82, Mexico, starting already from there. Right? The structural adjustment, the kind of austerity that has been imposed on Greece, has been imposed for decades before, throughout Latin America, Africa, etc., etc. Right? And yet, in this case, was very visible. Everybody saw it. There was no mobilization in any country of Europe. Where was the working class? When the Greek working class was being drawn to the slaughterhouse, where was the rest of the white European working class, you know, because talking about, right? They presumably will be in solidarity. They are against immigrants, they are against, but they should be in solidarity with the Greek worker, right? Where were they? There was not one mobilization, right? Some of them, yes, some left organizations sent them a solidarity message and they said, oh, this is terrible, that is happening, right? So obviously there's something that is taking place. And I think it's very important to understand that if we want to change the world, if we want to make some important, significant change, not in a utopian, I think I agree with Emmanuel completely, we have to really begin to understand, you know, all the many ways in which on a day-to-day basis, you know, in the structure, in the very structures of our reproduction, you know, we are being paralyzed, or we are creating, we are confronting ways in which our potential for change is being blocked. I mentioned one, I mean, in my 15 minutes, I mentioned one, but obviously, yeah, there's a much broader, as your discussion pointed out.
Just two short things I want to just say before we end. Just very.
Can I say this
sure.
first? Yes. There is obviously a flurry of activities now in different parts of you know, in Greece and outside of Greece to show solidarity with the Greek people. And this is a statement that has been signed by a number of organizations in Latin America, in the United States, in parts of Europe, to call for solidarity with the Greek people, but around something very specific, you know, because solidarity is easy also. In this case, is to help to build initiative that give support, you know, and not only by words, to the network of social clinics that over the years have been created in Greece. Social clinics are clinics that are built out of voluntary labor, basically, where doctors, nurses, and so on, since more and more it has been difficult for Greek people to have access to medicine because it's too expensive, and already they've gone through a lot of cuts, particularly cuts of pension, cuts of salaries, et cetera, which is going to get much, much worse. So the social clinics are going to be absolutely indispensable for the bulk of the Greek proletariat to have some access to some medicine, to a doctor, to a nurse, to some medicine. So this is a statement, and if you are interested, I can send it to you over the internet. I can send you to by email, but I brought some copies, and if you are interested, I can give you here. Yes.
Thank you.
I don't know.
We'll just The thing I wanted to just say very quickly is that the two things, and they're connected. The situation in Greece is being treated as it is. It's being discussed according to a nation-state model, when in fact the Greek government has incurred is a function of similar conditions of what Ireland and Iceland incurred. And that is because of the catastrophe of what went with financial capital back in 2007, 2008. And the reason I bring this up is that it's connected to what I said before when I talked about the production of white wealth. Well, similarly, the production of recent, really just absolutely rapacious accumulation of wealth was at the expense not only of the retirements of many people with hedge funds here, but also whole governments, as we see in places like Greece. But that is precisely because there has been an organization at a global level to facilitate the mechanisms of global financial capital. Now, the reason I bring that up is precisely because I don't see how we can deal with the ecological issues with the nation-state model. We're treating it as if it's in each state, these issues, but as long as we have a global situation in which a nation state could agree to or not follow a treaty, a global treaty of the environment, then it just cannot work. The fact of the matter is we have humanity right now is so compressed and so interconnected that anything done in one place really affects people in another. And that means that our political arrangements, which, by the way, our organization of how we deal with the mechanisms at a governing level of power are really out of the 18th and 19th century. One of the tasks we have to do as intellectuals is to think seriously for the 22nd century what a global arrangement of power for the welfare of the planet and all of us would be. And that would make a situation like what we see in Greece not only, it wouldn't even make sense, it wouldn't really be there, but also we'll actually be able to make viable steps towards dealing with the ecological issue.
Thank you. Okay. Unfortunately, Lewis and Jane can't be with us any longer. They're leaving the country tomorrow.
We're going to South Africa.
they're going out to South Africa. Manny is speaking on Saturday night on the workers of the Global South. And Sylvia with George will be speaking Sunday morning on Tales from Two Continents, both Mexico and Argentina, and then a social clinic from Greece that George has just returned from. One of the ways we're going to get to the a world for the 22nd century is getting to know each other. So let's hang out a little bit, have a drink. We cannot get solidarity going without knowing who each other are. And thank you, panel.
Thank you.
I promise steps for us that we'd be back at a certain point. What time is it? I don't know, but I think it's late.
Cars. Mm-hmm.